Okay, so in the previous videos, we discussed Splunk installation. We basically saw how you can install Splunk on three different operating systems, starting with Windows to Linux and then Mac OS. Now that you already have Splunk installed, what is the next thing that you want to do? You probably want to start using Splunk. And now, how do you use Splunk? The first and the most common way of using Splunk is through the web user interface. Of course, there are other ways of doing this that we're going to see, you know, in different videos as we go down the line. So the focus on this section and the next few videos is just going to be discussing aspects that are associated with the Splunk web user interface. Okay, so as we've just seen, you can use the Splunk web user interface in order to, you know, to use and administer Splunk. This is a very common thing. If you work in IT today, maybe in commercial environments, maybe you work with some application, you would notice that most of the time, the applications that you have would have a front end, which is a user interface, which typically will simplify things for you because it's just click, drag and drop, changing things and so on. But there is also a back end most of the time on the CLI where you can access more functionality. So this is not very different with Splunk. Splunk comes with this web user interface, but it is very, very powerful. So most of the things that you want to do in Splunk, just as a user of Splunk, you can do all of that using the web user interface. So you can run your searches, you can create knowledge objects such as alerts, you can create reports, you can create dashboards, and then there are even administration tasks that can be done from the web user interface. For example, you could add new users to the Splunk instance or deployment. You know, you can restart Splunk even from the web user interface and things like that. Now, how do you log in? Let's see again. Let's just recap here because we already saw this after installation. The default port for Splunk Enterprise is 8000. And then we saw that if you install Splunk on a local machine, you can use localhost and then the port number in order to access your instance of Splunk on Splunk Web. And then with the remote instance, such as we saw for an EC2 instance on AWS Cloud or a Microsoft Azure virtual machine, you have to specify the IP address that is associated with that machine. And then the last thing here, again, you need the username and password in order to log into your Splunk web user interface. So the username and password is what you created during installation. So we saw the installation in the different operating systems. There was always a step where you're going to set these credentials that you're going to use to log into your instance as an administrator. Now, let's talk about role-based access. So when Splunk comes, it's not like you as an admin can log in and do anything, you that install that instance, but it doesn't mean that you are the only one that can log in. What if you decide to create new users and say that, okay, now I want 10 users to be able to access this instance that I created? Are you going to give all the 10 users the same permissions? Do you want somebody to just log in on day one and have the ability to restart your instance, restart Splunk and just do maybe changes in Splunk, change apps and things like that, that maybe those are things that you wouldn't want someone just regularly logging in to be able to do that? So that is what you use roles to control in Splunk. Let's take another example. If you go into a building and you are given a badge, typically this kind of physical access with this badge, you're only going to be able to access some of the visitor areas. Now, for someone that works in the building, they might have a badge that will permit them to be able to, you know, have permissions to enter into certain other areas that you as a visitor wouldn't be able to do. And then you may have even people who work within the building. They have different access levels. Some of them might be able to get into server rooms, some not. Some of them might be able to access very high level information in certain rooms that others wouldn't be able to. So that is exactly how roles work in Splunk. So Splunk comes with 5 roles out of the box, but there are 3 of those roles that are very, very important because these are the ones that you assign to users. The first one is the user role. So if you add a user in your Splunk instance and give them the user role, then they have the least permissions. So basically with the user role, they can create their own knowledge objects. They have the ability to create alerts. They can create reports. They can create that, but they cannot share this information. So they cannot create shared objects. They just create things that belong to them. So typically the user will be somebody who is just a starter in Splunk, who are just kind of finding their way around. You probably want to give someone like that a user role until when they get more comfortable, then you can assign them the power role. Now with the power role, you are able to create these knowledge objects, but you are also able to share these knowledge objects, which means that if 10 people were using your instance of Splunk, for example, you can create something and share so that the other 9 people are able to see. But someone that has only the user role cannot do that. They cannot share any objects. So whatever they create is only going to be available to them. And then the last one here, which is the bigger one, is the admin. So you that install that instance, just as we saw for Windows, Mac OS, and Linux, you become the administrator of the instance. The administrator has the permissions for everything on the instance. So they can do what people with the user role can do, what people with the power role can do, and then everything else, such as restarting, performing administration tasks, adding other users, and things like that. Now, let's talk a little bit about apps. So you will notice as you're going with Splunk that everything that you do in Splunk has to do with apps. So apps will typically extend the functionality of Splunk. So Splunk comes like a basic feature package, where there are certain things that when it comes by default, you might not be able to do within Splunk. But if you, there's a possibility then for you to install an app or create an app to be able to do these things. However, there are some apps that come with Splunk by default. And what are those default apps? The first one here is what we call the home app. So when you eventually put in your username and password, and then you log into Splunk, you're going to see this screen, that's something like what I'm seeing here on the right side of my screen. I'm showing with my laser pointer here. That is what you call the home app. So once you log into Splunk, you land on the home app. And this home app is a default app. It's not like you have to install it. When you install your Splunk, it comes with it. The second one is what we call a search and reporting app. So now let's say that after installation of Splunk, you were able to index some data. Maybe there was some data sitting in a machine remotely, and maybe you decided that I'm going to install a forwarder on that machine, configure that forwarder to send data into my instance of Splunk. And then that data is available there. Now you want to search that data from day one. You don't have to go and install a separate app to do this for you, because there's an app that comes by default known as a search and reporting app that is going to allow you to search this data that you index into your instance. And then the next one, you can create custom apps. So it doesn't mean that when apps come by default, that's all you're going to have. So we're going to talk a little bit more about apps in the next video, but you can create your own app. So if there's some functionality that Splunk doesn't have, let's say, for example, that there was data sitting remotely somewhere and you can access this data with the REST API, for example, and then you realize that there is just no app that can be used in order to pull this data into Splunk, you can create your own app to do that. And ultimately, you can publish that so that other users can use as well. And then there is what we call Splunkbase. So when you're associated with Splunk, you have to understand what Splunkbase is, because as you use Splunk, you're going to go there so many times. It has over 1,000 apps that have already been created and available for you. So most of the time, you are trying to do something in Splunk, and then there is an app that already exists that can do it for you. So you just have to go into Splunkbase, search that app, download it, and then you install that app on your instance of Splunk. So in the next video, we're going to discuss more about Splunk apps.